This is how to get enough vitamin B2 or riboflavin from food. Hi, I'm Dr. Chris Masterjohn of chrismasterjohnphd.com, and this is Chris Masterjohn Lite, where the name of the game is details, schmetails, just tell me what works. And today we're going to talk about getting enough riboflavin from food. The RDA is set so that adult women need 1.1 milligrams per day, and adult men need 1.3 milligrams per day. Alex Leaf and I did a long podcast together where, in our analysis, we decided that people are better off getting 2 to 5 milligrams of riboflavin per day. And you could think of that as you want 2 milligrams per day if you don't have a lot of factors that increase your riboflavin requirement. So, for example, if you are sedentary, if you are on a high carbohydrate, low fat diet, if you are not exposed to a lot of light, you're not going outdoors a lot, you're not using tanning beds, and so on, then under these conditions, and you're not trying to lose weight, under these conditions, your riboflavin requirement might be closer to 2 milligrams per day. On the other hand, if you are eating a high-fat diet, if you're dieting a lot, if you're exercising a lot, if you are going out and tanning a lot, all these things are going to conspire to raise your riboflavin requirement, and that might put you up towards 5 milligrams per day. So if we're trying to shoot for 2 to 5 milligrams per day, how are we going to do that? Well, the number one source of riboflavin is liver. In fact, a serving of liver will give you, you guessed it, 2 to 5 milligrams of riboflavin. So if you were to eat a serving of liver a day, you would get all the riboflavin that you need. Unfortunately, you really shouldn't eat liver every day, or at least not if you're going to eat 3 or 4 ounces of it. You could certainly eat 1 ounce of liver per day. But if we're talking about 3 to 4 ounces of liver in a serving, we really want to limit that to 2 servings a week because there are other things in the liver like vitamin A and copper where we'd get too much. But certainly 1 or 2 servings of liver per week will do wonders for your riboflavin status. In the next tier, we could say kidney, heart, and almonds have 1 to 2 milligrams of riboflavin. So even these servings, if you're getting 2 of these servings per day, you're hitting your riboflavin requirement just in those foods. And you can see the value here of eating liver once or twice a week and then diversifying your organ meats with kidney and heart. In tier 3, we have red meat, cheese, eggs, salmon, mushrooms, seaweed, sesame, wheat germ, and wheat bran. These all give 0.4 to 0.5 milligrams of riboflavin. You can see here that you really need to get 3 servings per day of these just to hit over the RDA. And if you want to hit our recommendation for 2 to 5 milligrams, then you really need to eat more than 3 servings from that third tier, or you need to eat 2 or 3 servings from that tier and add some of the organ meats. In the fourth tier is other meats besides the ones that I just listed, besides red meat and salmon. And milk also falls in tier 4. These are providing between 0.2 and 0.4 milligrams per day. So you're going to need a higher volume of those tier 4 meats, and you're going to need a higher volume of milk to meet your riboflavin requirement. Whole grains, nuts, seeds, and vegetables, including beans and other starches, tend to have between 0.1 and 0.3 milligrams of riboflavin per serving. These really are only relevant if you're eating them in very high quantities. One of the things that you'll notice is that it's relatively hard to eat a vegan or vegetarian diet and get a high dose of riboflavin. And that's why you'll see that biochemical evidence of riboflavin deficiency is about 3 times more common in vegans and vegetarians. If you are vegan or vegetarian, then you really need to avoid refined foods, because if you're relying on whole grains, nuts, seeds, and vegetables, then yeah, you can work in some mushrooms, you can work in some seaweed, some sesame, some wheat germ and bran to give your riboflavin an extra boost, but you just don't have meat, you don't have milk, you don't have salmon, you don't have eggs, you don't have cheese, you don't have organ meats, you don't have liver. You do have almonds, right? But your food selection is limited from those top tiers. And that means that if you're putting oils into your diet and you're putting sugar into your diet as a vegetarian, then you're really crowding out that little tiny bit of riboflavin that you need from all of the lower quality whole foods. and it becomes very dangerous to start putting in junk. With that said, for anyone, including omnivores, the more sugar and the more fat that you put into your diet, the more you're crowding out good sources of riboflavin. And most omnivores are also not eating from those top tiers, especially the liver, the kidney, and the heart. Many people think that nutritional yeast is a good source of riboflavin. That's only true if it's fortified. Naturally occurring riboflavin is very low in nutritional yeast. One important point to make is that enriched white flour does contain riboflavin because it's added. I believe it's better to get your vitamins from natural whole foods. However, you can see that if you are health conscious, you could move away from refined flour and you could move towards, say, a high-fat diet. If you're doing that and you're not including organ meats and the other top-tier foods, you are probably decreasing your riboflavin status as you make that health-conscious series of decisions. Just as a vegetarian is going to need to plan their diet more carefully since they have fewer top-tier riboflavin-rich foods available to them, so someone who's eating a high-fat diet is going to need to be more careful about planning their diet because the fat is occupying space in their diet where they can't put those top-tier foods. For the person who just eats a lot of red meat, eggs, cheese, and salmon, they may not have to worry so much. But for someone who's eating high fat, it may be especially important to kick up some of those organ meats. For someone who's vegetarian or vegan, they really need to be careful about clearing out all of the sugar and oils and junk to be able to extract whatever riboflavin they can from the low riboflavin foods in high volume. But at the end of the day, you're just going to have more riboflavin if you eat liver. This episode is brought to you by Vitamins and Minerals 101. This is my new free 30-day course providing one lesson a day on each nutrient delivered straight to your inbox. It can go to your email or it can go to your Facebook Messenger. If you get the Messenger version, it's taught by Chris Masterbot, my baby bot. It's more interactive, there are more emojis, and there are more jokes. But both email and Facebook Messenger are incredibly educational. Each lesson covers why the nutrient is important to your health, how to know if you have too little or too much or the wrong balance with other nutrients, how to get it from food, and when you should think about supplementing. It is not a technical or advanced course. It is completely minimum in its technical jargon. And it is designed for the beginner with no background in nutrition and no background beyond high school in the basic sciences. Nevertheless, many people who have backgrounds in nutrition are saying that it is an amazing refresher course full of nuggets of valuable information in each lesson. Sign up completely free by Facebook Messenger or by email at chrismasterjohnphd.com/101. This episode is brought to you by Testing Nutritional Status, the ultimate cheat sheet. This is my recipe to empower you to banish any deficiency or nutritional imbalance from your body. I've been through the pain of my teeth falling apart, my stomach being in constant pain, and my OCD going off the rails during my stint with veganism, to the point where panic attacks were the norm and I was afraid to eat any of the food in my house. I've been through the path of healing using nutrient-dense animal foods to nourish all the systems of my body and become a new person. But I've also learned that my needs change over time. The red meat and liver that were so healing in my recovery from veganism later started sapping my energy and brain power, only to find out that I'm genetically predisposed to iron overload and need to manage it with blood donations. And I've learned from friends, colleagues, and clients that everyone is different. Your needs are not mine. Mine aren't what they were 10 years ago. Yours won't be what they are now in 10 years. That's why we need a precise recipe to know exactly what's missing, exactly what's overloaded, exactly what's imbalanced, and an action plan to fix things, and a way to measure our success. That's what I've done with Testing Nutritional Status, the ultimate cheat sheet. Get your copy at chrismasterjohnphd.com/cheat sheet and use the code LITE20, that's LITE and the number 20, LITE20 to get 20% off. For ad-free versions of these episodes with transcripts that you can read
and getting early access to the episodes, often weeks or maybe even months ahead of time, you can sign up for the CMJ Masterpass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code LITE10 to get 10% lifetime discount. The audio of this episode was enhanced and post-processed by Bob Davodian of Torian Mixing. You can find more of his work at torianonlinemixing.com.
All right, I hope you found this useful. Signing off, this is Chris Masterjohn of chrismasterjohnphd.com. This has been Chris Masterjohn Lite, and I will see you in the next episode.